in the media, and her sponsor is Thomas Valtram from the communication area and communication media and theater arts. So I'll give a chance for him to introduce Bailey.
It's an honor and a privilege to have sponsored Faith for this endeavor. Faith was a student in my classroom last semester, just as everything was getting underway for the undergraduate symposium. And she got up one day in class to do her persuasive speech. And she, I was speechless, and I'm usually not, when she was done. She did such an outstanding job with her presentation. And the topic was one that I felt needed a broader audience than the 24 of us sitting there in the classroom. And so I asked her if she would like to do this, and she said absolutely. So thank
you. Okay. So with a show of hands, who here listens to Beyonce? Okay, a lot of pretty high hives in here. Beyonce alone has a net worth of $450 million, earning her fortune from concerts, tours, albums, and all sorts of advertising. Unfortunately, though, Beyonce is a part of a negative representation of black women in the media that contributes to misogyny noir. As an African-American female myself who has lived my entire life in this country, I've experienced firsthand the psychological and emotional effects of anti-black misogyny in the media. Today, I want to share with you all meaning of the word misogyny noir and some examples of how it impacts young girls psychologically and how we, the consumers of media, can attack and change the cycle. Now, to break down and define the word misogyny noir. Misogyny, meaning the hatred or dislike of women, and noir, meaning French for black, combines to create the word misogyny noir. This was a term coined by Moya Bailey in 2010. Here are some popular representations of misogyny noir in the media today. We have, on the other side, the mammy presented in the movie The Help. We have the infamous gold digger presented in Kanye West's music video for his song Gold Digger. We have the angry black woman presented in Tyler Perry's Diary of a Black Woman. And my personal favorite, the independent black woman who doesn't need a man but can't have a man and a job, so has a selfish having a job, presented in the BET show Being Mary Jane, which originally was going to be called Single Black Woman. What all these stereotypes have in common is that they're misrepresented realities for black women in the United States. By creating entertaining images out of social issues such as poverty, we become desensitized to very real issues and learn to laugh at them. But to understand the current misogyny war, we must go back in history and explore its roots. Colorism is the most clear aspect of misogyny war in media. Colorism dates back to the enslavement of Africans. This is the house slave versus field slave mentality. The slave who worked in the house was usually lighter skinned, around the master, around his resources, and therefore more educated. The typical field slave was darker skinned, less educated, less favored. They did the dirty work. Fast forward to today, and we have hashtags like Team Light Skin and Team Dark Skin. These terms are used predominantly by African Americans towards each other. We have internalized this oppression that separated us years ago, and now we separate ourselves based on the same thing, skin tone. In the media today, the only way for a black woman to be beautiful is to be teen light skin. Celebrities such as Nicki Minaj have their skin tone, eye color, and hair texture artificially altered in order to fit into this definition of beauty, which really is becoming as white as possible. Though white women are also discriminated against in the media, we live in a society that values whiteness over all other colors, and in a society where a woman's self-worth is heavily based on her appearance. Therefore, white women, in their skin tone and straight hair, give them privilege over women of color as more beautiful, more valued, and more respected, while black women must deny their features and their skin color in order to fit into this image of beauty, and especially to become suitable for a man, because that's the most important. Black women are also highly over-sexualized in the media. In the film Killing Them Softly 4, Jean Kilborn talks about the objectification of women in ads, specifically presenting them available for his use. When black women and people of all races and genders are exposed to these images, the damage becomes psychological. As I mentioned previously regarding colorism, black women look at these images and internalize the oppression. In other words, they begin to measure these impossible standards against themselves and others of the same race. Black women who do not want to be identified with these negative stereotypes go through a phase of total self-denial, denial that they are black, and assimilation to white American culture. Part of this assimilation can include skin bleaching and using chemicals to permanently change the texture of their hair. This is a psychological battle that can last throughout adulthood, and a battle that can never, ever be won. In The Souls of Black Folk, W.E.B. Du Bois describes America as a world which yields him no true self-consciousness, but only lets him see himself through the revelation of the other world. He speaks on this inner battle, stating, "One never feels his two-ness, an American, a Negro, two souls, two thoughts, two unreconciled strivings, two warring ideas, and one dark body." In the case of young black girls surrounded by misogyny, the battle is between who she really is as an individual and how and who the rest of America expects her to be. In the 1930s, two psychologists, Kenneth and Mamie Clark, conducted a doll test among young black children and identified white bias in all of them. White bias is the tendency to attribute whiteness to beauty, intelligence, and good behavior. In a 2005 film called A Girl Like Me, Keri Davis reconducted this test with black children found the same exact results. It is not shocking, but it is very saddening to know that nothing has changed since then. Misogyny noir is such an important issue in American media today. So what can we do about it? How can we attack this cycle? The first step is to educate ourselves and others on this topic. Misogyny noir in the media is not something people want to talk about, especially since we are the reason the media thrives and able to put out these degrading images. But the discussion must start somehow. Listed here are just some of the great literature and films to enlighten us and equip our minds to attack misogyny noir. We need to actively demonstrate that we do not want to see these images of women in movies, music videos, and advertisements, and that we do not want our generation and our children to continue to be harmed by this. When we support the media and give into the promoted consumerism, we are doing just that, harming others and allowing them to continue the cycle for future generations to bear. So why invest our money in those things? In order for us to truly want change, we must learn to value black women as people and uplift them for being the beautiful people that they are. We as black people in this country need to stop dehumanizing one another. We've endured enough dehumanization from other races, and when we are turned against ourselves, we are distracted from who is really turned against all of us. As I conclude today, I want to reflect on the images of misogyny we are bombarded with from day to day. As I've discussed, those images are filled with stereotypes and hate that harm black women's self-image and allow others to view them as less than human or as entertainment. This problem is not an overnight fix. It will take many years and much passionate advocacy for change. We are the consumers of this media, so we must become those advocates. So I challenge you all, the next time you listen to Beyoncé or see her in an advertisement, consciously watch and listen. Be aware, analyze and respond. Be brave enough to challenge your mind against the desensitization that it has endured from this misogyny noir. Feminity is not the same thing, so, you know.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Misogyny Noir, this is the first time that I've heard the term. When and where was the first time?
It was coined by Moya Bailey. She's a queer black feminist, and she coined the term in 2010, so it's relatively a new term. But it's used now formally it's called anti-black misogyny, but she just turned that into that word. So it's used by a lot of black women now to just describe it without having to say anti-black misogyny.
This isn't a question, but it's like something for you. You should read the book Bad Feminist by Roxane Gay because it's wonderful.
Very cool. Thank you very much.